Tēnā tātou katoa. There are 17 days to go. Welcome to the Newshub Decision 2020 Leaders Debate in a COVID-19 election under level 2 restrictions. A bubble of 100 voters, most undecided, are here at the Q Theatre in the heart of Auckland. And one of the women we're here to see will be Prime Minister of New Zealand after October 17. Let's bring in the leaders of the Labor and National parties, Jacinda Ardern and Judith Collins. Okay, we will start the debate with COVID-19, and we want to see how these two will lead us in the face of another community outbreak. It is Christmas Eve. Ashley Bloomfield informs you there is community transmission in Christchurch, the exact same situation as in the recent Auckland cluster. What do you do? Do you lock down and force people to cancel their Christmas plans? Judith Collins, you won the coin toss. What would you do if you were Prime Minister in that situation?
Well, in that case, if there is a community outbreak and it's in Christchurch, you'd have to lock down Christchurch. That's pretty clear. You'd have to do that. You'd also have to establish quite how far the community outbreak had spread. So, of course, we would have by that stage a border protection agency, would have the COVID tracing app. We'd also have Bluetooth technology so that we could very quickly lock down the parts of the country that needed it. In that case, it would be Christchurch. Once we established exactly how far it had spread and where it hadn't spread, we'd be able to bring that lockdown in. And I just think that's what you've just got to do.
Yeah, so you would lock down Christchurch on Christmas Eve, cancel their holiday plans. Would you potentially lock down the whole South Island as well?
Well, it's not the whole South Island, is it, Christchurch?
No, would you go that
far? It's very important, but it's not the whole South Island. I think we need to understand that. But I think you do have to put people's health first. But at the same time, if your border protection agency is working properly, you're doing the testing at the border, you test people before they get on a plane, you shouldn't actually have to have a lockdown because you shouldn't have it in the community.
Jacinda Ardern, what would you do in that situation?
I would do exactly what I did in the real life scenario. We already had a resurgence plan and we activated it. We knew that we needed at least 3 days to assess fully how far the outbreak had spread and see if we could trace the origins. So I would move to a lockdown, a short one, so that we could assess the situation and assess whether or not we needed to lengthen the time.
You said you'd do the exact same as you did in Auckland. So would that mean level 3 in Christchurch and level 2 in the rest of the country at Christmas Eve?
Absolutely. Until you establish the spread of the virus, that's critical. You know, we have spent time learning from overseas jurisdictions. It's one of the reasons New Zealand is now amongst the best in the world. We've learnt from others. We saw that if you delay those decisions, as unfortunately we saw in Victoria, you can have a catastrophic event which leads you to being in lockdown longer.
So it would be small Christmas gatherings for everyone of under 10 in the whole country, because that's what level 2 is.
Very unfortunately, we would have to move in that way in order to assess the full spread. You know, what I don't want, Patty, is a situation where if we make the wrong decision, that we have a situation where families don't spend time together at all because they lose their loved ones. That is the gravity of these situations that we as a government have had to make.
Judith Collins, would you go that far, level 2 for the whole country, or would you be more flexible in that sort of situation?
Well, I think you have to take the advice of the health professionals.
Well, the advice is exactly the same as it was in Auckland, so would you go as far as Jacinda?
Well, I would be very concerned to do that, and the reason I'd be concerned about doing that would be that it actually not only does it lock down the country, it locks down the economy, but also, as we saw with the last lockdown in Auckland, that also affected the South Island. There was no community spreading in the South Island and they still suffered. So you've got to be very careful about this. But, you know, what we've seen is if we have the COVID tracing, if we have all those things in place,
you are saying the
Border Protection Agency, and we test people before they get on plane, Paddy, that's how you keep
Petty
it out.
Yes, but you would do it differently from Jacinda Ardern. You would keep the North Island open in that scenario and keep business going.
Unless we had a reason otherwise, and I think we need to take the advice on that.
But Paddy, the advice and the evidence I can already tell you because I've read it and I know it well. the advice and evidence is that there is a very high chance of spread outside of a singular city if you've not yet identified the source of the outbreak. Yeah. To make a decision like that, sadly purely on what would be at that time, I'm sure, significant public pressure, which comes in this job, to make a decision like that would to put people at risk. Gatherings of 100 are allowed.
You're saying Judith Collins would put New Zealanders at risk?
Well, I think one of the problems is...
To do anything
is,
other than
that's...
to first establish spread would be dangerous, okay. Would be risky.
Well, actually,
okay,
then
that's what I'm hearing
then. Why
here.
Are we now talking about a trans-Tasman bubble then, if Ms Ardern's so worried about it?
Well, let's come to that trans-Tasman bubble and keep talking about this Christmas, because people do want to see their brothers and sisters and sons and daughters who are across the Tasman. You are Prime Minister, we're coming up to Christmas, and Scott Morrison calls you wanting to start the bubble. Judith Collins, you've already been talking about it. What do you say to Scott Morrison? What conditions do you put on it? Is it safe enough to do it by this Christmas?
By this Christmas? Take the other scenario out of the way? Well, it should be, because we'd have the Border Protection Agency in place. We would have the COVID tracing. We'd have the COVID card or Bluetooth app. And by the way, no one's getting on a plane to New Zealand under my government if they have, unless they have a negative COVID test. So that would have to be in place. So that's really important.
So you open the bubble by Christmas?
But only if it's safe. And that's the thing, Paddy. You can't make these decisions now.
What does safe mean then?
Is that there's no community transfer, there's no COVID-19 in New Zealand other than that which has somehow come through the border on planes, and there's no community transmission. You'd also need to make sure there's none...
In Australia, though, what does it need to be in Australia?
As you know, you can't have the community transmission in those particular states. And I already, you know, I'm very aware that there have been discussions between Ms Ardern and Mr Morrison around certain states, and obviously Australia, but the states themselves have different conditions, and certainly no one's talking about Victoria because they are a cot case, unfortunately.
Okay, so you potentially open it to some states without community transmission by Christmas. Jacinda Ardern, what do you do?
Oh, Paddy, again, this isn't a hypothetical. These conversations have been going on for some time, and there has been enormous pressure over a period of time for New Zealand to open its borders, not least from a number of different opposition leaders at the time saying that New Zealand should have already opened. I disagreed. I withstood that pressure because in my view it wasn't safe to do so, and I will continue to maintain that standard for the safety of New Zealanders.
So what does that mean in terms of opening the trans-Tasman bubble by Christmas?
We established criteria that says there should not be community transmission in Australia when we open our borders. They've changed their mind though, Paddy, and decided they want a hotspot arrangement. That means they'd close off states or areas in Australia for travel to other parts of Aussie or to New Zealand. They've not yet established what a hotspot is. We need to do a bit of work with them, but I'm clear. I will withstand that pressure as I have till now and only make a decision to open when it is safe to New Zealand and meets our standards.
So could that be by Christmas or not?
Well, that depends on the status of Australia and its cases, but certainly not right now, Paddy.
Let's move on to the Pacific, and coming to you again, Judith Collins. When will that be open for people to see their families or holiday? How quickly do you want to get the Pacific open?
Well, of course, a country like Samoa, it closed its borders a month before New Zealand did. So much for hard and early. They actually did. And by the way, they've had no COVID-19 in Samoa.
We were one
and
of the earliest stopped, countries
and they
in
stopped,
the world
well, Ms. Ardern, you've had your
to
turn.
Shut our borders.
Manners. Also, we've had what they do in Samoa. People don't get on a plane without a negative COVID test. It's funny, you know, a country like Samoa, only 200,000 people, they seem to be able to do the things that Ms Ardern doesn't seem to think New Zealand can.
So when do you open the border to Pacific if you're Prime
Minister?
When
they want to do it as well, and when we are absolutely certain, Paddy, that we're not going to spread...
So are you going to give a date or not?
Well, once it's safe. And the thing is, it should be safe.
Jacinda
Ardern,
when are
you
going to open to the Pacific?
First thing, if I may, Paddy, first thing. If it were as easy to just establish a border force and COVID would disappear, every country in the world would do it. COVID is much trickier than the leader of the opposition is giving any credit to, or credit to New Zealand and this entire team for the work that they have done to establish themselves as world leading in our response. First thing. Second thing, tests before you fly do not prevent COVID being carried by a traveller. That's why quarantine and multiple testing is so important.
Then why
and on the Pacific, And on the Pacific, because health agencies in some of those countries don't have the capacity to offer it.
No, the
problem is, New Zealanders need to come home.
Actually, Ms Ardern told New Zealand...
To the Pacific, Patty, if I can answer. If I can answer the question on the Pacific...
told New Zealanders in June, 23rd of June, that border-facing staff were being tested. Turned out two months later, only a third of them had been tested. So actually, that's the problem. Don't do the testing that you promise.
And now I will.
Well,
on the Pacific, we spoke, of course, with Niue, Tokelau, the Cook Islands, our realm countries. Now, of those three, a couple of them are not ready to open up, and for us, they have to be ready.
Are you going to put a date on it or not?
Well, of course, it's not just up to me. We can't be so paternalistic, Patty.
We've got to move quickly now.
They don't want the same thing to happen as measles did when we exported it.
There's plenty of time to debate which one of you will open the border up to international tourists and international students
first. Well, we have a plan to do it.
When?
And that plan is when we have the Border Protection Agency in place, when we have the testing regime in place that we can trust, when we are testing people before they come on a plane. And by the way, Patty, once we know that we can be safely do that, then we will. But we actually have a plan to do it.
Yeah, and will that be next year? We've heard a lot about this plan tonight.
I don't think we're going to have international tourists in New Zealand outside those where there is no COVID transmission or no community transmission until next year. I think that's pretty clear. Also think a vaccine is something that is apparently on its way.
Okay, but what if a vaccine takes years or potentially never comes? Tell Kiwis, both of you, what is your plan B? Jacinda Ardern, is there a point where you would be prepared to let the virus into New Zealand and try and manage it here?
There is absolutely nothing in any of the science, research or evidence to say that we will be in that scenario, Patty. And we're investing in research ourselves here for that very reason. Those who I've spoken to who have good experience in vaccination say that they believe next year we will see a range of vaccines, different efficacy around them, different quality levels in terms of their longevity,
assumptions that you're making, Jacinda Ardern.
They are certainly not. I base my decisions on science and evidence, and that's where I've based this assumption that we will have a vaccine next
year. Just about every country in the world is looking for a vaccine for COVID-19. I believe that there will be a vaccine for COVID-19. Personally, I will be happy to sign up to be injected with COVID-19 vaccine, because actually I think that's what we should be doing.
We all want a vaccine.
Yeah, I'm sure.
But what if there isn't one? Do either of you have a plan B for New Zealanders?
Well, we are going to have to. I think New Zealanders actually have a zero tolerance to having COVID-19 in the community, which is why they were so let down by the lack of border testing.
The border does not open under either of you until there's a vaccine.
Patty, we actually don't need to.
I don't think you need to.
We don't need to set a hypothetical, because we can see around the world what the plan B is.
It's not a hypothetical, it's real life.
You can see what the plan B is. You only need to look at other countries in Europe. The plan B is coexisting with COVID, people losing their lives and living with ongoing restrictions. New Zealand chose another path. We do not need to consider the idea of coexisting with the virus, because all of the evidence is pointing to a vaccine.
Lockdown, using technology, trusting people, getting people to do exactly what they're supposed to do, and strangely enough, 23 million people, and they've had very similar numbers to deaths as we have.
Okay.
So come on,
It's the elimination strategy or nothing, Jacinda Ardern.
Yeah, at this stage, I'm sticking with that plan.
I think it can be done.
Yes,
properly.
Quick question then before the break. We've made so many sacrifices to get to this point. Now, how can we capitalise on our COVID response and our COVID-free status? What is one idea that both of you have that could push New Zealand forward? Look into the future and quickly give us something visionary. What is one transformational idea that will change the lives of New Zealand?
We need to trade on our brand. Now, we're already seen as clean green, and now we are safe as well. That gives us an opportunity to bring in investment, and we're already working in partnership in different industries, but to continue to support our exporters as well. And that's already in train.
So trade on our brand is your visionary idea?
Because everything that falls away from that is significant, be it screen, be it exports, be it innovation. People want to come here, Patty, and we should capitalise on that.
We've lost $21 billion in exports from international tourism and international students just by itself. But what we can do is we've got $8 billion of exports and technology. So that's not only IT, but it's also high-end engineering, whether it's in health, care, whether it's in all sorts of areas that we're involved in. So what we can do, which is why we promoted, I announced a tech policy about turning New Zealand into a tech centre, particularly a tech bubble
so
for your, the
your
South Pacific.
Your transformational
so,
idea is tech.
So a really, well, working off UFB, the ultra-fast broadband.
Okay, great. RB, all right.
Yep, actually bring people here.
Coming up after the break, COVID-19 has come at a massive cost, massive debt. How do we pay for it? Don't go away. Welcome back to the Newshub Decision 2020 Leaders Debate in front of a great socially distanced audience at the Kew Theatre here in Auckland. All right, it is time to talk economy, and I want to start with the wage subsidy and a moral question to both of you. Big companies took millions of dollars in taxpayer cash, then laid off workers and are now posting huge profits. Sky City, Briscoe's, Somerset Holdings, to name but a few. My question to you is it fair, Jacinda Ardern, is it fair that they have done that?
No. And I expressed my view at the time when I heard that the warehouse was one of those groups who was taking a similar position. You know, the wage subsidy helped retain 1.7 million, million people in work. And it may be within the rules to do what these companies are doing. It doesn't mean it's in the spirit of fairness.
So it's morally wrong what they're doing?
Yeah, I think it's wrong.
Judith Collins, I'll come to you on that. Do you think it's morally wrong as well what those companies are doing?
Yeah, I believe that $500 million a week, which is pretty much what it is, that's the same amount of money to build a regional hospital like Hawke's Bay or Dunedin or Christchurch. If people don't need the money, they shouldn't have taken it. But then again, the rules should have been more carefully put in place, but they should pay it back. It's not fair. New Zealand taxpayers are going to hock to pay for that. It's not fair.
OK, so to both of you, it's morally wrong. You both want them to pay it back, I take it. How do we get them to do it? If you're Prime Minister, Judith Collins, will you try and claw it back?
Well, I will, actually. I think it's absolutely outrageous when we've got the sort of borrowing we've got at the moment. We've gone from 20% borrowing to looking at 40% by the end of this year. It is absolutely outrageous that every other New Zealand taxpayer is paying for it when they don't need to have it.
So how, yeah, how I'd would say you do that? I mean, you might have to change a law or something.
Well, we may have to change a law. I would have thought we would have had a lot of support in Parliament to do that. It's simply not fair. But then again, unfortunately, the Labor Party went and put in a rule that obviously big business could get through.
Jacinda Ardern, you're shaking your head during this.
Well, I stand by the wage subsidy. You know, as I said,
That's not the question, though. You said it's morally wrong for these companies to take money.
Yes, and I also said they stuck by the rules, Patty. 1.7 million people, we managed to get that money out the door quickly to save those jobs by making sure that it did run on a high trust model. You are able to search the names of every company that drew down that money.
That's exactly how people have found this out. The question is not about the wage subsidy. You've said it's morally wrong. Judith Collins would change the law to make them pay it back. Would you do the same or not?
No, I would not. Okay. Well, I would, but if I may, Patty, we are also pursuing those who may have acted outside the law. But that's why I said it was a moral issue. Okay. Some of these companies followed the rules. They just didn't follow the spirit of fairness.
The rules, unfortunately, were wrong. And the fact is that the government was naive and it's dealing with this.
That's interesting. So
and that is really important. That's really important to now talk
about
the morality
the
of it. Is that clearly people could take the money when they didn't need it. They were taking money off taxpayers, borrowed money, by the way, off taxpayers, that taxpayers now have to pay back. That's simply wrong.
This is the first time I've heard National say they didn't support the wage subsidy.
Oh, we absolutely support the wage subsidy, but what we didn't support is actually the sort of lax rules that clearly allow people to have made enormous amounts of money off it and then turned around and sacked those workers. That's outrageous that was allowed
again,
to
happen. I've heard of that, Patty, that they didn't support the wage subsidy.
Yeah, well, he didn't say that, did he?
Yeah, well, let's keep moving and you can debate a few other things because there's plenty more to come. The cost of COVID is enormous, $58.1 billion. This wage subsidy is part of it. That's a bill of $32,000 for every household in New Zealand. This debt will fall on our children. In fact, it will fall on our grandchildren. How the hell are we going to pay it back? Kiwis want to know. Judith Collins.
Right, well, for a start, we grow the economy, which is why it's really important to put confidence back into those small business owners who are wondering how in the world they're going to keep staff employed, because they're not the big beneficiaries of the largesse of the borrowing. They're people who are having to pay their bills and at the moment are waiting for their leases to expire.
Grow the economy. Jacinda Ardern, how do we pay this money back?
We already are starting to see us grow our way back up. Our exporters are seeing growth. We've seen our wine industry, our kiwi fruit. We've seen, you know, beef.
Okay, so grow the economy is the way to pay this back as well?
Absolutely.
That's both of you. Make it real for somebody at home who doesn't understand growth. Give the people at home one real new idea of how you'll stimulate growth.
Right, for a start, every average wage earner will get $3,000 in their pockets back for a 16-month tax break, and that's so that they can help grow the economy.
So tax cuts is your idea, Jacinda Ardern?
No, a sugar hit is not what we need right now. It is irresponsible. That, again, is only going to add to the debt that we need to keep a lid on. We should be investing in our people, investing in their skills, investing in their ability to then go into high-wage jobs.
What's your idea very quickly?
Invest in our people. Make apprenticeships free. Make vocational training free. Get them into vocational jobs that grow the economy.
Okay.
Actually, I look at this with tax cuts for average earners, $64,000 a year earners, those people, teachers, nurses, those people. And I say, OK, if it's irresponsible to give them $3,000 of their own money, then what in the world was it to give people like the warehouse all that money in wage subsidies, and every New Zealander, those nurses and teachers, are having to pay for that?
Patty,
actually, that's irresponsible.
Patty, if you believe in our teachers, give them decent wages like we did, not a 16-month sugar hit. Give them decent pay, full-time,
$3,000 might be
round,
your sugar bill, but I can tell you it's
months.
Not for families.
OK, so in terms of that debt, I'm still not clear exactly how both of you are going to pay it back. Growth and a couple of ideas there.
Patty, if I may,
that's
on
one.
Debt,
you only asked one.
Yeah.
There is no country around the world that hasn't had to take on extra debt. We, however, when we came in, reduced New Zealand's debt and got us into a good position.
Yeah.
It means we start well. Secondly, we've also said we will put in a new top tax rate. That helps us bring in extra revenue, so we don't cut...
It only brings in $500 million a year.
So we don't cut services.
It will bring nothing.
And, Patty, if I may,
so you
the National Party's fiscal plan
wage
has,
subsidy.
At the
That's
same time...
It means nothing.
Judith Collins is right, Jacinda Ardern, isn't
nothing.
She? It's 1 week of the wage subsidy,
that's
your tax
that's
hike.
It's a waste.
I will never, ever say that $500 million is inconsequential.
Then why did you waste it?
Judith Collins...
companies like the warehouse. Why did you do that?
Judith,
why did you do that to people's savings
Judith Collins,
for our children and grandchildren to pay back?
Judith, if I may, modelling a little good behaviour on the stage, if I may. On the opposition side of the benches, we're seeing a fiscal plan with an $8 billion hole.
No, it hasn't. There
we
is
have
actually
not
a fiscal
seen
plan.
An explanation
no
for where it's come
from. There is no
fiscal
plan from Labor Party at all. There's no fiscal
that is
plan.
Okay,
in
Judith
zero.
Collins,
let's get
on the record for New Zealanders. Yeah. How many mistakes did Paul Goldsmith make?
There was one mistake around one particular $4 billion. But
that
tell
is,
you what...
That is not true.
Yes, and I have the letter from the NZIER, the experts on this, saying that there is no double counting, there's nothing else. All it means, Patty, in another 8 years, we'd be down to 36% debt to GDP. Actually, all that we've seen from the Labor Party is 48% debt to GDP by that stage. So a lot, their plan, what there is, the only number I could find apart from 48% debt was COVID-19.
Okay.
That's their plan.
On numbers, Patty, how many mistakes did Paul Goldsmith make, in your opinion?
Well, the ones that are extraordinarily notable are the two that leave an $8 billion hole. But no, there are more.
It's not $8 billion at all.
There are more.
There are not.
And Patty, that is not inconsequential. $8 billion is significant. We still have
not
heard an answer
from
the leader of the opposition.
I think you two could go all night on these holes. So we've got a whole lot of other things we want to talk about.
And
some of it's really important, like housing, because house prices are still out of control in this country. And Jacinda Ardern, 3 years ago in this debate, you stood right where you are now and said to New Zealand that the unaffordability of housing was due to, and I'll quote you, a failure of leadership. But since you took office, the median house price has risen by $145,000. Have you failed as a leader?
No. But some of the things that we've tried did not succeed. And I will acknowledge that. We had a minister who paid...
I saw that too. I saw Ms Ardern on the stage saying to you that she would have 16,000 homes in Kiwi Build built within 3 years. You questioned her about who was going to do it. You said, who's going to actually do the building? And you said, we have to write 50-odd thousand people come in to do that building. And she said, oh, no, we only need 5,000 on the Kiwi Build visa. What happened? No Kiwi Build visa. And by the way, 585 houses out of 16,000.
Very quickly, though, Judith Collins, how can anybody trust anything you say after you were part of the national government where housing went through the roof as well?
I'll tell you what.
So, in fact,
Patty, that's unfair. Housing's gone up 27%
the prices, 27% in just 3 years under Ms Ardern. The State House waiting list has gone from 5,000 families to now almost 20,000 families in just 3 years.
And another 16% in the next four.
And 5,000... Okay. No, and 5,000 state houses that are being built. All planned and funded under National. So actually, no, and her party refused to help on any RMA reform, which is utterly crucial to building houses. That's why you can trust me, because I'd get it done.
OK, we can throw numbers... We can all throw numbers about housing around. They all go up. I think we can all agree that. But here is a question for both of you that will clear this up for New Zealanders, where you stand on housing. Do either of you want house prices to drop? And it's a yes or no answer. Do you want house prices to drop?
I don't want them to keep escalating.
Do you want them to drop? That's not the question.
It's not sustainable. But Patty, you know, at the same time, we have to make a difference to the number of houses that are being built. It will be the only thing that will stabilise the house prices and stop this continuous escalation.
So you don't want them to... I'm not really clear. You don't want them to...
If we keep building houses, if we increase supply...
Do you want house prices to go up or down?
I don't want them to grow, Patty. Simple.
Okay, so you want them to just stay where they are.
I want them to stabilise so that people can get
Judith
into
Collins,
the market.
Do you want house prices to go up or down?
In some cases, they're going to have to go down, but I agree. You don't want to have people who have borrowed up to the hilt to buy a house suddenly having negative equity. And that's, I think, the problem that Ms Ardern has.
Neither of you actually give me a clear answer on this.
But I can tell you the way to do it, look at Christchurch. We got rid of the RMA for the purposes of the earthquake rebuild, and actually we built so many houses there that house prices there have actually dropped and they're completely stabilised.
Okay, quick right
That's
reply
how you
on
do
that.
It.
Patty, what I would say is if the RMA was the solution,
it is.
Why did Judith Collins not do it in 9 years?
We tried
that she
to,
was
but
in
you
office.
Wouldn't give us your votes
she
to help us get it.
State
we were a minority.
Houses. She
actually,
sold
you
state
have
houses.
Two, $300 million worth.
We're going to have to close this up because up next we've got...
Come on, you've been selling them as well. Why don't you...
Deep breath.
We're going to have to close this up because up next we've got an important topic coming. Cannabis.
Well, that'll be a deep breath, won't it?
Thank you. Right, welcome back to the Newshub Decision 2020 Leaders Debate, live from the Q Theatre in central Auckland. Now, let's talk about our children and one of the most tragic crimes, actually, child abuse. Children and babies keep getting killed in this country. And in some cases, the witnesses aren't talking. There are now calls to abolish the right to silence so that those witnesses have to talk. Judith Collins, is it time to abolish the right of silence in child abuse cases?
Yes, and we have promised that there will be a removal of that for those people who know about child abuse and who stand by and let this happen. We've actually had enough of this as a country because no child ever deserves to be abused as some children are. How many children have to die? Kahui twins are those that are most known. Delcelia Whitaker, many other children. And all the time, now we hear the story that the family will not cooperate with police. Well, actually, I've had enough of it, and I've said they do that, they can go to jail for 3 years, and while they're there, they'll think about their actions.
So is that the same? Is that the same, giving them a charge of going to jail for 3 years, as removing the right to silence? Because they're actually two different things. You said you would remove the right to silence, which is a very significant change to New Zealand legal rights. Would you remove the right to silence?
It's effectively the same, because it's very much like the Serious Fraud Office has... people do not have the ability to not either present their evidence or else it will be, you know, basically held against them. It is very similar. It's... Actually, do you know what, Paddy? I think New Zealanders have had enough of hearing about our children being killed and abused. We've all had enough of it. And by the time, isn't it right for us to stand up for these kids who clearly don't have families who will stand up for them?
OK, Jacinda Ardern, would Labor under you remove the right to silence like Judith Collins would?
The broad sweeping right to silence in our justice system, no.
It is child abuse cases.
In child abuse cases, Australia's already tried it, not one trial. What I want is people held to account and to go before our courts for child abuse. The police should charge, have a go at getting an offence, prosecute those they believe to be responsible. Someone must be held to account in these cases, and almost every time it is someone in the family who has had the obligation of caregiving. We need to test it before the courts. Get them in front of the courts.
Sorry, that's what happened with the Kahu
twins. We all want them in front of the courts. The question is whether you would do anything about the right to silence, which is used before the courts. The answer appears to be no.
Paddy, it's been used overseas and it didn't change a thing for a child. If we want this to be about the child, we are obliged to look at what has worked. In Australia, they had this law changed. They've not been able to bring one successful conviction.
Actually, it's just naive to think that the police are going to get convictions when you've got a whole group of family members all saying, not me, and worse than that, refusing to speak. The Kahui twins, the police charged the father in that case, and he got off. I don't think for a moment that those children were suddenly killed by a stranger. It was clearly in the family, and that family stuck together against their own children.
And after that case, the national government changed the law and it still hasn't made that difference.
All right.
Do you know what I think, actually, Paddy? This is a moment for us both to acknowledge. Neither party wants to see child abuse in our country. Neither party wants to see anyone get off without taking responsibility. The conversation should be about how do we make sure that happens in our justice system.
That's what the conversation was actually about.
And I actually don't think there's a political divide here. Let's stop this
and talk gangs, because there's been 1,459 new gang members, nearly 1,500 since you became Prime Minister, Jacinda Ardern. Now, that's something you can both agree on, that is shocking. Is that shocking?
So 30% increase in gang
members. Yes, of course, any increase in gangs.
So what is one thing that you will do to stop it increasing? Very quickly, Judith Collins.
Well, we have a gang... We obviously have the gang intelligence centre that the police set up.
What would you do differently?
We'd have a gang squad, and they would go after those gangs, take their money off them, take their assets off them. We started that whole process
Shouldn't they be doing
that
now?
And we'd do more of it, but the police need to be actually focused on that, and they need to be back to do it. The
more
other
money?
Thing is...
More
firearm
money for gangs?
Prohibition office. Firearm prohibition orders, which the government of Ms Ardern refused to put in, so the police can go into the gangs, just go in, take their weapons out,
Jacinda
get
Ardern.
Rid of them.
Actually, that's
that's
not
what
true,
you have to do.
Jacinda Ardern,
you did.
What would
your
you, what's one thing
to
you're going to do if you do get back in?
Address the desperation that leads to our young people thinking that's a future.
How?
Because that is our problem in New Zealand. You know, I just last week was talking to a young man that did go into a gang lifestyle. The difference that made for him was someone believed in him, supported him to find meaningful work. He's now running a fitness centre and changing other people's lives.
Yeah,
we have to give our young people hope and optimism, skills and training.
So skills and training, skills and training. So will either of you commit to actually stopping the rise of gangs?
I can't let that just pass, Paddy, because Miss Ardern is saying it's all hope and, you know, love and stuff. Tell you what, how come the gang members have gone up numbers by 30% since she has been the Prime
because
Minister?
Because when you were Minister of Police, when you were the Minister of Police, the rebels came into New Zealand and took a foothold
30%.
Here.
That
and
was
your
actually
response
what,
was to issue a press statement
ago.
Saying
six
they
years
should
ago.
Leave.
Yeah.
Six
Paddy,
years
there
ago,
is no credibility here on
Come
gangs.
On. Yeah. Six when years ago,
when Judith was Minister of Police.
Ago.
The police numbers declined
okay,
on
to,
her
I've got to break
watch.
This up. It's like
no
the
credibility.
Hero versus
no,
the Mongols out here, and I need to get to methamphetamine. I need to get to methamphetamine because that's causing wreckage everywhere, including in almost all our small towns. I want to pick one small town, Fielding, and I want to find out from both of you what you will do for the people of Fielding to stop the meth crisis. What will you do for them, Judith Collins?
Well, first off, on the health side, put in detox beds in all of our DHBs, but also the Matrix meth program, which has been very successful in the United States. Dr. Shane Retty has brought that into New Zealand, really talked to us about it, about 70% a success rate, enormous compared to the 12%.
So,
that's one. The other thing, go after the sellers of meth, because I tell you what, they're not getting a free
one.
Ride
you're,
under
you're,
us.
You're allowed one. Fielding would get a meth program funded from
and,
you as Prime Minister.
And,
just say it. Tell Fielding they'll get it.
They'll have it available to them in Palmerston North.
Jacinda Ardern, what would you give Fielding?
We have to have addiction services across the country, and I'm pleased now, some admission that we need that because...
I put it in every prison.
In Tidafati, when we came into office, the whole East Coast, not one bed for addiction.
So we are
building our services across the country, and I agree.
Fielding
has to be able to access that, but so does everywhere else in the country.
Are they going to get anything or not?
Oh, we already, in almost every DHB, have built addiction services.
They've got nothing. Are they going to get anything?
We are rolling out a huge amount of funding to build those beds.
Only 7 out of 20 have got them at the moment. We've put them in all 20.
Okay, we've got a big vote coming. It's not just for both of you. It's about cannabis. Judith Collins, have you ever used cannabis?
No, I have not.
Jacinda Ardern, have you ever used cannabis?
Yes, I did, a long time ago.
Judith Collins, how will you vote in the referendum on recreational cannabis?
I've made it very plain that I will be voting against the legalisation of the sale and recreational use of cannabis in our country. I want to protect the mental health, particularly of young people.
So you're voting no?
And I'm voting no.
Okay. Jacinda Ardern, how will you vote in the referendum on recreational cannabis?
Paddy, you know that I made a clear decision that I want the public of New Zealand to decide this, and I want this not to be about politics.
Yes or no, how are you voting in the referendum?
An
and I'll be giving my answer after the election, after New Zealand has decided.
So you won't say yes or no and how you're voting
I can tell you what I won't do, whip my entire caucus and tell them how they have to
we
vote.
We didn't have to do
Paddy,
that at all,
if you could actually just come back to the question.
How will
you vote on the cannabis referendum, yes or no?
I want the public to decide. And I want them, Paddy, to have faith that whatever they decide, I'll implement. I'm not clear if that will be the case under
Judith Collins, does she deserve to have the right to silence on how she will vote on this
important thing?
No,
it's hardly the right to silence.
No, I'll tell you why. Miss Ardern has been very clear where she's voting on the end-of-life choice referendum. She's very clear on that. She was very clear on where she would have voted on abortion and all these other things.
Yes, and I advocated on it.
And actually, this is a very serious matter because her own government asked Boole, the economist that they like to use, to look at what this would do in this country. 30% increase in cannabis use.
So should she tell New Zealand or not?
400 cannabis shops up and down the country. Yes. New Zealanders deserve an answer and they deserve a straight answer.
Paddy,
not a waffle.
My vote... Paddy, my vote in this is the same as your vote. Look, I will take leadership on issues every single day of the week.
But you're not going to tell us. You're not going to tell us, so can we just get on to another question?
And, but also...
About the advice from your own chief science advisor, Jacinda Ardern. Yeah. You're not going to tell us, so we'll keep moving. Māori are 3 times more likely to be arrested and convicted of a cannabis-related crime than non-Māori. Is that unfair and is it wrong?
Yes, it is unfair and yes, it is wrong.
Is that a reason for people to vote yes?
Well, it's a reason for us to fix our justice system, Patty, because cannabis is one example. I'm sure that you'll find...
It's a pretty big example and you could wipe it off the books by voting yes.
But it will not...
No, but you could.
It will not solve a problem.
If you need some help to make a decision...
...across our entire justice system.
You know, if you need some help to make the decision, I'm full of information on the topic. OK, quickly before the...
So I've noticed.
All right. Still to come, and more important than ever before, how will these leaders look after your health? Stay with us. Welcome back, everybody, to the Newshub Leaders Debate. This great audience is here. Now, Jacinda Ardern, very quickly, how is your te reo Māori journey going?
Not as well as I would like, Patty, but...
Yeah. Well, I'm working on it too, so...
Wāki tōno tātou.
Yeah, well, here goes from me as well. Me tōko te reo Māori, ki roto I nā kura. I'm saying, should teaching today be compulsory
in schools? Yes, I picked that up. First, we have to have the teachers. You know, I think we will move to that over time, but we can't do that until we have the teachers. We've trained 1,000 ambassadors in Te Reo Māori in our classrooms, and I'm proud of that, because that's laying the foundation for Te Reo.
In your heart, should it be compulsory? Is that
what you're
saying?
I want every child to learn, so it should be in every school.
So it is in your heart that it should be compulsory?
Yes, it is.
Judith Collins, do you want compulsory Te Reo in schools?
No, I want New Zealanders, all New Zealanders, to want to learn Te Reo with their children. When I went to school, Te Reo was not available. And I actually think it would be, many New Zealand families are very happy for their kids to learn Te Reo. But I think that it's something that New Zealand is coming through. You can see it with some of the big businesses now adopting Māori Te Reo words whenever it suits them, basically. But also, it is something that I think is important.
Do you think if you became Prime Minister, it would be something you'd need to learn more of?
Well, we've made it compulsory for every child to have a second language
at school.
No,
I'm talking about you personally. Do you think you need to learn some more?
Oh, I think I do. I do. Yeah, absolutely.
And is that something you undertake to do?
Well, I will. I've got Haiti Hapango, our MP in Whanganui, who is doing her best with me, but I say it's still a work in progress,
yes,
Paddy. Big work in progress.
Okay, now speaking of education, I want to talk about the Green School, $12 million given to a private school. Judith Collins, yes or no, because we need to get on with things. Was that wrong?
It was absolutely wrong, and Miss Ardern gave into the pressure on it.
Jacinda Ardern, was it wrong to give that money
to the
Green
School? We should be discussing this under the infrastructure section, because that's what it is, 200 jobs.
Okay, the question is, was it... So are you saying it was right? It's not wrong?
No.
So it's right? It was the right thing to do?
Yes, it was.
To give the money to the Green School?
Yes, it was.
Okay, all right, good.
And a new permit?
Judith Collins, can you...
Just like it's right to give over $3 billion to make sure that we're investing in every state school in the country.
Tell that to schools all over the country that are falling apart and see what they say.
And that is why we are funding them, Paddy.
Okay, now... Can you name a school then, Judith Collins, in your electorate that could do with $12 million?
Yes, actually, Papakura High School, and I've already talked to Nicola Willis, who is our education spokesperson, about how that school needs to be completely rebuilt. We rebuilt two schools in my
electorate. It needs to be demolished. It needs to be demolished.
It needs to be demolished and rebuilt. But then again, we also did that for two schools in my electorate, the Gardens and also Red Hill Primary.
Okay, that's three schools. They'll be pleased with the shout-out. Jacinda Ardern, is there any schools in your electorate that need $12 million?
Well, every school has needed funding. That's why we gave them $400
million. Are you going to name one that could do with $12 million?
All of our schools could do with additional funding, and that is why we have put $3 billion into
funding. Okay, if you're not going to name one, I'll name one for you.
Oh, Paddy, I've said every school. No, I'm not going to say there's no one. Every single school.
I'm asking you for a school in your electorate, and you haven't given me one, so
I can name all my Mount Albert Grammar.
Yeah, that, how much money does it need?
They all need funding.
Mount Albert
Paddy.
Grammar needs $40 million, Jacinda
Ardern.
They all
need funding, Paddy. And 200 schools were overcrowded when we came into office.
Okay, we'll move quickly on to health now. We've all seen plenty of Dr. Ashley Bloomfield this year. Could you quickly both describe him in one word? And I'll start with you, Judith Collins. One word for Ashley Bloomfield.
I've never actually met him, but I think he's competent.
Competent, okay. Jacinda Ardern, one word for Ashley Bloomfield.
Considered.
Okay, one word now, Judith Collins, for the health system, the New Zealand health system, in one word.
Actually, generally a good system.
That's a few. All right, Jacinda Ardern, one word for the health system.
Generally.
Broken.
Yeah, I'd agree with that as well. So why, geez, you've admitted the health system in New Zealand is broken.
When we came in, you know, it was from opposition benches. You know, our perspective was it was underfunded, and it is, Paddy, it is.
How long will it take to fix it? Let's not talk about the past, the future. If it's so broken, how long will it take to fix it?
Well, I certainly need another term.
Well, you've done nothing in the meantime.
I mean, it's a funny reply, but put a year on it. You're the one who said it's broken.
It's also true.
Put a year on it. How long will it take to fix?
Give me another term and see what we're able to do with it.
Okay, you'll fix the health system in a term. We'll hold you to that.
Okay, so what'd you do the last one?
And we'll see you back here in 3 years' time. Now, let's focus on one part of it, cancer.
Yes.
People in New Zealand are dying because they can't afford the drugs they need. Yet those same drugs are funded overseas. Which one of you has the better plan to make these life-saving cancer drugs available?
$200 million
to a health for cancer drugs.
Okay, $200
and
million.
A cancer agency for that. Dr. Shane Reddy is the Minister of Health.
Dr. Shane said
much
two
better
mentions.
Than a part-time.
How much money will you give for these cancer drugs?
Well, Patty, given actually both parties are pledging the same amount in drug funding, it's going to come down to a matter of who you trust to invest it. Now, when National were in government, there were years where they gave PharmEC no money. We've had a 20%
increase. What? How'd you get the drugs then?
And so that's just going to come down to a matter of trust on this
so
one.
So both of you are giving the same amount, $200 million over 4 years.
Well, this is specifically cancer drugs.
$50 million a year, but it's pretty much the same amount. So I want to talk about one cancer then, because you've both got the same amount of money. So let's put one cancer out there, lung cancer. Yep. 1,600 people a year die from lung cancer.
Yes, I've got that's a brother-in-law at the moment with
Yes, it's three. About 30 a week. Mm. And Keytruda,
really
I'm sorry to hear that, Judith Collins.
Yeah, it is, actually. It really upsets me.
And Keytruda, it upsets me too. And Keytruda has been proven to save lives, but it is not funded for lung cancer. Get this. PharmEC says it will cost $50 million a year for Keytruda. That's all of your money spent, and that's all of your money spent, and it's only one cancer. The simple fact is neither of you can help the people out there with cancer in New Zealand right now.
With that sort of money, you'd have to say, Paddy, you've got to get people diagnosed really early. And my brother-in-law was like some other people who couldn't even get in because of the lockdown and got told over the phone that he had terminal cancer. That's what's happened. So let's just put that aside and say this. The only way to grow our health budget is to grow the economy. We're already spending $20 billion. Okay. That's the entire amount of our dairy
exports. So you've admitted you don't have enough for the cancer.
Well, we've got some.
Jacinda Ardern, how will you help these people because you've spent all your money just on Keytruda?
Politicians can't make those decisions, Patty. You know, and I have to say, it has been one of the things that I found the hardest in this job. Whether it's cystic fibrosis, whether or not it's cancer treatment, there are a long list of drugs that are needed by people who are experiencing huge suffering. Politicians should never make those decisions.
Politicians give the funding. You've brought up cystic fibrosis. Politicians give the funding, which helps make the decisions.
We've got to keep increasing the funding, and we will.
You've brought up cystic fibrosis, and I want to talk about that to both of you for a minute. Mm. There is a 17-year-old girl on the North Shore called Bella Powell who has cystic fibrosis. She is able to get a drug called Trikafta, but it costs hundreds of thousands of dollars because it's not funded. Bella Powell says she will die without that drug. Neither of you have put in the money to keep Bella Powell, and you brought it up, Jacinda Ardern, and 508 other people with cystic fibrosis in New Zealand alive. What is your message to those people? Is it to stay on Give a Little and keep begging like they are?
Paddy, PharmEC, when they made those decisions, the last decisions, when we gave them extra funding, that benefited 200,000 people who got drugs, just like the ones you're describing. But, Paddy, what you're asking us is to be the one to decide. When we give that money of where it goes, we should never decide that. It would be wrong if it was our call, and I'm sure Judith would agree with me. Our system has to allow clinicians and experts...
OK, very quickly then, let me ask this final question about PharmEC. Are either of you prepared to have an investigation into the way it does things, because that's what the people are trying to get...
Yes, actually, I am, and I'm able to say that. We actually did, in opposition,
Will you have another one?
Yes, we will. I think we should.
An investigation into PharmEC. Jacinda Ardern, an investigation into the methods of PharmEC on behalf of these people we're talking about tonight.
If it gives people faith in our system, then yes.
OK, so you promise an investigation and you promise an investigation. Moving on now to Māori Health. Māori have some of the worst statistics out of all of our health statistics there are. They die 7 years earlier than a Pākehā. You know, is the health system racist?
Well, when you have outcomes like we do for take cancer care, you know, for every cancer that New Zealanders experience, Māori have worse outcomes with one exception, and that's melanoma. You know, when we started on the work looking into our health system, having given record increases to our DHBs,
is it clear. Do you think it's racist?
It's clearly showing bias. It's clearly not working for Māori. So, matter what you want to call it, Paddy, it's not working, and it has to be fixed.
It's racist. It has to be fixed. Judith Collins, is the health system racist?
No, I don't think the system's racist. I think what that's often used as an excuse, because some people are racist, actually, Paddy. And sometimes people make decisions
about the health or what operations or what treatment can be given to someone based on their own biases. It's called unconscious bias.
So there are racist people in the health system.
I think that there are actually some racist people in New Zealand, and I'm sorry to say that our family has been subjected to that occasionally.
In the health system as well.
Well, I'd say that I don't want to call a system racist. I tell you why I won't, because that's giving an excuse to those people who are.
All right, we've got to go to the break now. Back in a moment with a simple but surprising question for both the leaders. Okay, welcome back to the Newshub Decision 2020 Leaders Debate here in front of these uncommitted voters. Judith Collins, coming to you with a quick question. How many times a week do you eat meat?
Sorry?
How many times a week do you eat meat?
Possibly two.
About two times. Yeah. Jacinda Ardern, how many times a week?
Yeah, I'd be about two.
Okay, that's pretty low, so you're going to be on the good side of this question, both of you. I'm asking this.
Eat a lot of fish.
Yeah, fish counts, actually.
Oh, is it? Oh, OK. Yeah. Well,
according to Clark, there's not enough fish in our house. Yeah,
so. OK, yeah. great. The reason I'm asking this is actually serious. It's about climate change. Mm. Sir David Attenborough has just called for people to eat less meat, and that includes fish. It is the single biggest way to reduce your environmental impact. Less meat, less livestock, less greenhouse gases. Would either of you consider eating less meat for climate change?
Well, I already considered that we're probably eating on the fairly low end of the spectrum, but this is an opportunity for New Zealand. If everyone is scaling back on the amount of meat that they're consuming, let's be the meat that they choose. By being a country that is fulfilling its climate obligations, that alongside our farming community is showing the world what climate-friendly agriculture looks like, we need a premium product
would you support something, just staying back on climate change, and we'll come to that, would you support something like meat-free Mondays? New Zealand is doing that for climate change.
I think actually more health, Patty. Health reasons, I think there's nothing wrong for New Zealanders cutting back on meat, but for our exporters, actually, we produce such a small portion.
So meat-free Mondays are a thing. Where you kind of into it?
For health.
Yes, of course you can. Just go on. Sorry.
Okay. Number one, if you're going to eat
meat-free Mondays, meat-free Mondays, are you into it?
No, if you're going to eat meat, eat New Zealand meat, because our meat producers are the best in the world, and we have the lowest level of carbon emissions for our meat. So if you're going to eat it, eat New Zealand meat every single time. And no, I'm not going to tell people when they can eat their meat. I'm not into communism. I'm actually, or fascism. I'm actually into democracy. People can make their own minds up. It's their money, it's their meat, it's their bodies. Give people a bit of freedom.
Very quickly, I didn't realise David Attenborough was a communist. But you do you. Okay. Yeah. Jacinda Ardern, you called climate change your nuclear-free moment.
Yeah, how's it working?
Judith Collins, what kind of moment is it for you?
Well, for me, it's actually the biggest moment at the moment is the economy, but I think it's an opportunity for us in New Zealand to do the right thing and to support the world in this issue.
So what kind of moment is it?
Well, it's one of the many moments that we have to deal with.
All right.
And I'll tell you what, the number one thing is this, when you produce 0.17% of the world's greenhouse gases, New Zealand is actually not the problem, we're the solution.
Patty, Judith has said this before, if every country in the world took that approach, that our emissions didn't matter...
Well, they do matter,
we would
I didn't
do
say
nothing.
That.
No country would do
that.
Anything. The Paris Accord would fall over, and climate change, which requires every country to do its bit, would unfortunately continue on the path
it
already
like
is.
To see China,
we have to take
India,
responsibility
US,
for
our own emissions.
I'll just cut into the middle
we're
of this. I'll just cut into the middle
really
of this. Because last year, tens of thousands of school children marched in our streets calling for a climate change emergency. Mm-hmm. Jacinda Ardern, why haven't you followed them? Why haven't you called this an emergency?
There was a vote in Parliament on whether it was an emergency, and National voted it down.
Well, I'm asking you.
It is an emergency. It is an emergency, and Patty, everything that we've done demonstrates that.
Why don't you declare a state of emergency like they want?
I've just said what happened in our Parliament.
No, sorry,
Patty,
who's got the numbers in Parliament?
Patty, an emergency in real terms means stopping future offshore oil and gas exploration.
Okay, but hang on, I just want to follow up on that. So if you have the numbers, next time you get back into Parliament, either yourself and with the Greens, will you declare the emergency?
I would have no issue with that at all.
So that's a promise?
Yes.
Yeah, okay.
So now she's using...
What about you, Judith? Is it an emergency? Is it an emergency?
I'm going to think about this. The oil and gas exploration ban, what did that do? Actually, our coal use has now gone up. So now we've got more coal being used instead of natural gas to actually create electricity. Actually, our carbon emissions have gone up in the last 3 years, not down. So all the talk, all the fluffing around about emergencies, tell you what, actually, it's got worse, not better, under this particular leader.
What is your plan?
What for, dear?
Climate change.
Climate change. Okay, well, I'll tell you what. Number one is this. We support our New Zealand farmers. Number two, we give them the science to help them cut their carbon emissions, and that we use science to do that. What we do not do is that we do not beggar them and our country in order so that we can go and get a photo op somewhere. What is really important, Patty, is that we understand this. You're asking us about health drugs. You're asking us about Keytruda.
let me tell you this, $20 billion is what dairying brought into this country, and $8 billion meat. And I'll tell you this, Paddy, you can talk all you like about emergencies, but there's a big emergency right now. It's in Taranaki, where 3,000 people have lost their jobs because of Ms Ardern and her ban. And
totally
the other thing is
$30
million dollars
over 30
years.
Picking up on this point, what do you say to farmers who are saying, look, it's getting really hard to run my farm, I can't afford what Labor's going
that
to bring
we can
in the
lift the value of their product on the world stage, and they're already seeing that when you have a high quality product, when consumers are looking for something that they can consume feeling like that it's a conscious choice, we benefit from that, but only if we do our bit.
New Zealand
and
is
Paddy,
already.
you're from Taranaki.
I am.
You know that in that region, yes, they've thrived as being an oil and gas region, but now's the time for us to look to what the new energy opportunities are for Taranaki. The world is changing. Unfortunately, Judith Collins does not want to change with it. Unless we move quickly, we lose an opportunity.
Look, if Jacinda Ardern is going to use my age against me, I'm happy to use my experience.
It was
I'll tell
not
you
age,
this. I'm
was,
not going to say...
It was not
to
age, Judith. It was ideology, and yours is
Taranaki
outdated.
High-earning engineers...
Okay, well, speaking of Taranaki, because you've brought it up, Judith Collins, you're rolling back regulations that are cleaning up our waterways. That's what you're doing to help farmers. What impact will that have on people like me who want to swim in our childhood rivers?
I'll tell you what, we didn't say that, did we? We said that we would be reviewing and looking at them. I tell you what, Ms Ardern's government...
You're looking at letting livestock back onto wetlands.
Well, actually, Paddy, what we've said is you have to have a policy around regions, because actually not every region is the same. The weather in Taranaki, as you know, is entirely different from the Coromandel. The weather in Northland is entirely different from Southland, and so are farming practices. So some of the regulations that Ms Ardern's government rushed through in the last day of Parliament, actually all that they're going to do is limit farmers' ability to do a better job, and that's important. It didn't even come through Parliament.
Quick rush
through the last day of Parliament.
That's not true.
It was
we campaigned last election to stop the degradation to our waterways. And, you know, I refuse to believe that this is a blame game. Farmers want swimmable rivers too. We have to work together to make sure that we have those standards.
All right, got to go to the break. Up next, they both want to be Prime Minister. We put their leadership values to the test. This will be good. All right, welcome back to the Newshub Decision 2020 Leaders Debate. Now, I want to turn to leadership, starting with you, Judith Collins. Quick question, is Winston Peters irrelevant?
Yes.
Jacinda Ardern, is Winston Peters irrelevant?
It would be a disservice of someone I've worked with for that long to describe him in that way. But ultimately, voters are going to make that call, Patty.
OK, so voters might make him irrelevant, is your answer. Judith Collins, do you rule him out then? Is there no way, even with some miracle that Winston Peters gets back, that he would ever be involved with any national government new leader? Are you ruling him out totally?
As a Christian, I do actually believe in miracles, but I tell you what, he ain't going to be one of them.
OK, so that sounds like he's out. Jacinda Ardern, do you rule out working with him with the shadow of the SFO hanging over him?
Do
you rule him out this time around?
Look, when it comes to the SFO, you know...
No, just ruling out Winston. Let's not relitigate
glass
that.
Glass houses for politicians right now in that
oh,
respect.
Actually, that's
for
very
political
disappointing.
Parties.
Very disappointing.
For every... I include Labor in that. All
very
of us are facing issues with the SFO right now. So I'm not going to cast aspersions there. What I am going to say is that for Winston, I've worked with him for 3 years... We achieved a lot. In the last 3 weeks of a campaign,
we've got to move quickly, so we don't need a history of this. You're not going to rule them out. Let's look forward. It's October the 18th, Jacinda Ardern. You don't have a majority. You don't have Handbrake Winston, but you do have the Greens. James Shaw and Marama Davison come to you saying that they want to job share as co-deputy prime ministers. What do you say?
I would say I do not recommend that for your relationship. I just... I don't see job-sharing arrangements in politics working particularly well, Patty.
So will you rule out a co-deputy prime minister?
Look, Patty, I've never got into coalition negotiations in these debates. So, little dance last time.
Okay, so you might have a co-deputy prime minister. Turning to you now, Judith Collins... David Seymour comes to you, you need his numbers to form a government, and he wants to be Deputy Prime Minister. Do you say, and maybe a clear answer this time, do you say that's okay?
Well, I think David Seymour is a person of principle. I've worked with him before.
So he'd be a good Deputy Prime Minister for you?
He'd be excellent, in my opinion.
Be an excellent Deputy Prime Minister, David Seymour. Okay.
Jeepers.
Absolutely.
Okay,
Well, I mean, the gun laws, that's the first thing. I actually asked you about the gun laws.
Yeah. When this excellent Deputy Prime Minister is there and he says he wants to roll back the gun laws, do you negotiate on that? Are you open?
The way it works, if I'm the leader, is actually it's the Prime Minister who makes those decisions. It's not like Winston Peters bossing around Ms Ardern. It's not like that. It's not like him being now apparently the handbrake on the government. Actually, no, that's what the Prime Minister and that's what the majority
do you tell him he can or can't roll back the gun laws?
No, we will not come back from the first tranche that we supported, which is around the military-style semi-automatics.
So I want to make
and
this,
they can, however, we believe that there should have been exemptions for the shooters' associations in terms of
those sporting, and also
we did not support the second tranche, which Ms Ardern's
done. Judith Collins,
the gun register is gone under National.
Well, it's clearly is because it hasn't gone anywhere under you.
The gun register.
Sorry about it, but you've actually failed.
You spent about
$150 million
to
do what?
We've just introduced a gun register, and obviously now the National Party wants to rid New Zealand.
Look, come on, the police can't even go and get the guns off the gangs, which we wanted them to do with firearm prohibition orders.
Judith Collins, please clarify that the gun register would not happen under National.
Well, it won't be happening because it's quite clearly impossible and because they've wasted $150 million.
The gun register is gone. Make it clear to the people of New Zealand that the AR-15, which is the semi-automatic weapon used in March 15, would never come back into this country.
Well, it is currently in this country.
Okay.
And that is for the use of pest control and professional pest control
and
people.
For the
sporting shooters. But I tell you what, not being sold as though it's just a normal gun. That's absolutely no reason.
I've got to move on because that took a lot longer talking about firearms laws and David Seymour than I wanted to. But anyway, we're going to keep moving. Ihu Mautau, is it sacred land and should a deal be done, or is it private land and should the occupiers get off it? And very quickly, it's a very simple one.
It's why we're having this debate, because it happens to be both. It's privately owned by Fletchers, and it's been determined to be heritage land. And that is why there's been a dispute.
So should a deal be done, yes or no?
We have to find a solution.
So that means you're doing a deal or have you done one?
We have to find a solution.
How much money?
Yes. a solution needs to be found, because the alternative is that you have a private landowner who can't build and you have heritage land that is occupied. It is not acceptable just to sit back and say that there is nothing to be done in that situation.
Okay, so you say do a deal. So how many other treaty deals have been put up in
there? No, I did. I said find a solution. Patty, I've always been very clear.
There is a solution.
Good luck with that. Good luck with that without a deal.
We cannot undermine...
Yeah, okay, the trouble is that Ms Ardern got herself into trouble as leader of the opposition going and saying that there should be a deal done. Three years later, we don't know how much money she wants to spend. What I can tell you is, Patty, that's private land. It was actually provided to Mana Whenua under a treaty settlement.
They should get off that land,
and I'm not paying a cent of taxpayer money for it.
And
I just want to make that really clear.
And what if Fletchers can't build?
Not one.
Okay. And they have the land because it was a special housing area created by that government.
All right.
That government started the ball rolling on a problem, and now we have to fix it.
That's 400 odd houses. That's almost as many as the $2 billion Kiwi build houses that she built. Come on.
Jacinda Ardern, can you quickly name for me, moving on to foreign affairs, can you quickly name for me a current world leader that you respect?
Yes, I can. Pedro Sánchez from Spain, Prime Minister of Denmark.
Angela Merkel.
Okay. Now, can I please ask you both, what about Donald Trump? Do you respect him and the way he handled COVID-19? Judith Collins, you're nodding.
I thought it was a difficult call. I actually thought he... I don't know.
Do you respect
I don't think
them?
He did.
Do you respect
I'll tell you
them?
What, I thought quickly. He could have done better myself.
Okay, all right. Jacinda Ardern, she thinks could do better.
You'll
what do you think of Donald Trump?
You'll know my views. You know, the idea that we would be compared to the outbreak in the United States by President Trump, obviously I totally rejected that.
Okay.
And I stand by our response.
I'll ask you straight up then. I want to be really straight up about Donald Trump. Jacinda Ardern, I'll come to you on this. Is he a dangerous influence on the world? Yes or no?
I will work in New Zealand's interest, and that means if democracy delivers Donald Trump, that's who we work with.
So is he a dangerous influence?
You asked that question last time, last election. The same question.
Yeah, well, same problem.
What I've seen is, I can give you something a bit more than that. And I agree with Ms Ardern. You've got to work with whoever the leaders are. You don't get to choose the foreign leaders. But what I can tell you, he has actually done some quite recent stuff with Israel and UAE and also others. So actually, that's better. That's better than war, don't you think?
Okay,
he hasn't been ready to rush into war.
It is a worry when the best thing you can say is at least we haven't had war.
Well, actually, it's a damn sight better than any of the other presidents that have been there before, including those that you admire, Ms Ardern.
Okay.
Actually, I think keeping away from war is a good thing.
Okay, so in 2020, a lot of things, as we now know, are about brands, social media, influencers, all this sort of stuff is around us. Judith Collins, could you describe to me, in your own words, quickly, brand Jacinda Ardern?
Oh, well, I think she means well, and I think she's well-intentioned, and I think, too, that she's very, very good communicator.
Jacinda Ardern, what is brand Judith Collins?
Very assertive in a debate.
Damn right.
Okay, Judith Collins, staying on this topic.
Thank you.
Staying on this topic, you have called Jacinda Ardern a celebrity prime minister.
Yes,
So,
what does that mean?
Well, it actually means, Ms Ardern, is that overseas, you know, people know who you are, and I think that's lovely. I think it's good for New Zealand.
I think
that's a good thing. Is there something wrong with that topic?
You know,
can't even give a compliment.
Judith Collins. You know, would you seriously say no to being on the cover of Vogue?
Oh, absolutely would I like to be there. There's no problem with that. I tell you what, Patty. Any political leader who says they wouldn't is a liar.
All right. Jacinda Ardern, on the same thing, and, you know, be honest here. Have you ever referred to Judith Collins as Crusher in private?
I haven't, actually.
Okay. No, isn't that sweet?
All right, after the break.
There's been my other things.
Okay, after
she's
the break.
Used other words.
My favourite round is coming up. Quick fire.
Oh, right, okay.
Okay, welcome back. It is now time for our quickfire round, and quickfire means quickfire. So, Jacinda Ardern, should New Zealand be renamed Aotearoa? Quickfire.
Not right now, Patty.
No. Should New Zealand be renamed Aotearoa? Quickfire.
I agree, actually, on this one. I think. All right. Not yet.
Yep. Should we have 4-year terms for governments instead of 3? Judith Collins.
Yes.
4-year terms, you support.
Gosh, okay. We might be able to do that.
It's great. Okay. You guys can talk.
We don't want to see you for 4 years.
That's good.
I don't have much time to get you back, but I'll
try.
All right. Okay. Can both of you rule out any new taxes in the next term, Judith Collins?
Yes.
We've already put out.
Okay, good to have it on the record. Should we ban sugary drinks from schools, only water and milk for the kids?
I don't want to ban it. I think schools are already doing it. I think they're taking responsibility.
Yeah.
Okay, you're both agreeing again. You can talk about that as well afterwards. Yes or no, is it responsible to keep the superannuation age at 65? Is it responsible, Judith Collins?
At the moment, but we plan to raise it in about 17 years to 67.
Is it responsible, Jacinda Ardern?
Yes.
And will you continue to keep it at 65?
Yes.
Will you resign if you put it up to 67?
Yes.
Okay.
So you change
just
your mind.
Getting that on the record. All right. Is it impossible to totally eliminate child poverty in New Zealand? Totally eliminate it? Is that just a dream, Judith Collins?
I don't think it's totally impossible, but I do think...
Jacinda Ardern, is it impossible to eliminate child poverty?
As we understand it, no.
Okay.
As we understand it, no.
You can eliminate it?
As we understand it.
Can you eliminate child poverty or not?
Oh, well... Technically, as we understand it, we can.
Do we need to bring an end to what's called period poverty and fully subsidise sanitary products for every woman and girl in New Zealand, Jacinda Ardern?
Yes, I think we should. But what I'm actually doing right now, though, Patty, is rolling out free products into schools. So that's something I can do.
But will you go further and subsidise all sanitary products?
All we can end up doing is subsidising companies. That's why I'm putting it for free in products in schools.
So will you put it free anywhere else? Or
at the moment, schools. And from there, I would happily look at ways that we can make it more available.
So you'll do that next term if you get back in?
Yeah.
Okay.
I think you've got to put it into schools. I mean, it's just awful to think kids are going through this and staying away from school because of what is a very natural part of growing up as a young woman. And actually, I don't see any problem at all with agreeing on in terms of schools. But I, like Ms. Ardern, I would be worried about subsidising some of the biggest pharmaceuticals in the world,
quickfire, Judith Collins. So I'll just move on. Does every school need gender-neutral toilets for transgender people? Jacinda Ardern, I'll come to you.
Every child should be able to go to a bathroom they feel comfortable going to. Schools are going to design that, and they have to.
Okay, so will you help schools do that?
Sorry?
Will you help schools do that?
We should help schools do that.
Schools should be having at least one bathroom available for kids and who don't want to go to either a boy's or a girl's bathroom.
Okay. You'll help them do that if you become Prime Minister?
It's only one bathroom, for goodness sake. People can do it even at the office.
I've got to keep moving.
To kids who are going through difficult
100% with you. Gloria Vale, ongoing allegations. Is it time for a proper, wide-ranging, independent investigation or inquiry of what is going on down at Gloria Vale? Judith Collins.
Can I tell you, I just think it sounds really weird. That's really weird. And I am a feminist, you know, as well as a Christian, so it's amazing. I actually think, somebody needs to go. I understand WorkSafe is going in there. From what I heard the other day, it sounds like
as Prime Minister, would you have an independent inquiry? It's quickfire, Judith Collins. Help me here.
Yeah, okay.
Okay, Jacinda Ardern, quickfire. Would you have an independent inquiry?
No.
Okay. Will we actually be, and this is quickfire, smoke-free by 2025?
No, well, we won't if you're going to have cannabis.
Ardern?
I'm not giving up on 2025. I'm sticking with it, Patty.
New Zealand will be smoke-free by 2025.
That is up to every single person in New Zealand who smokes right now, but we are not giving up on that goal.
But we're going to have cannabis instead.
Okay. Jacinda Ardern, just play a quick game. Asset or liability? Phil Twyford.
He's still in my cabinet. He paid a price.
Asset or liability?
Well, if he's in my cabinet, then yes, he has qualities.
Judith Collins, is he an asset or is he a liability?
Well, he's my asset and he's Miss Ardern's liability. But she
Judith Collins.
She promoted him to number four.
more.
Judith Collins, coming back to you then, and we'll play the same game. Asset or liability, Paul Goldsmith.
Oh, he's an asset, absolutely.
Jacinda Ardern, is he an asset or a liability? But
their fiscal plan is the liability,
No, it's
Paddy.
Not. We have one. You don't have one.
Remember, it's quickfire. Yep. Next question. Is politics a blood sport? Yes or no?
Yeah, it's an enjoyable sport, but I don't think anyone has to shed blood, and that's important.
Is it a blood sport?
No
blood.
It shouldn't be. No.
Okay.
I want people to come into
quick
politics.
Quickfire. Should we put a statue of Kate Shepherd up in Parliament's grounds? Yes or no?
Yes, of course we should.
You'd do it if you were Prime Minister?
Absolutely.
Okay.
Why shouldn't we?
Will you do it as well? Will you put a statue?
I actually think Trevor Mallard's already working on it, actually, Paddy. I might have let the cat out of the bag.
So you'll do it? A statue of Kate Shepherd's going up if you get back into...
We're actually trying to make Parliament a UNESCO site for the fact that Kate Shepherd is the reason we were the first country in the world to have women...
Are you going to put the statue up if you get back in?
We've already got a bus.
Straight
yes,
answer.
Why not? But Paddy...
Okay, great. Okay, this
Paddy,
is the hardest...
Paddy, that is not the only thing we can do to honour women.
We're holidaying at home at the moment, but where is somewhere in New Zealand that you've wanted to visit but have never been? Judith Collins.
Oh, easy. Chathams.
Okay.
I need to go to the Chathams.
Okay, that's your summer holiday sorted. Jacinda Ardern, where's somewhere you want to go that you've never
been? I haven't got to Stewart Island.
Okay, great. Summer is sorted then for both of you. What is your favourite native tree that best represents you, Judith Collins?
That would be a kowhai.
Kowhai? Jacinda Ardern?
Pohutukawa.
Would you chain yourself... would you chain yourself to a kowhai or a pohutukawa to protect it?
No, I'll tell you what I would do. I'd plant some.
Okay.
It's far better.
Jacinda Ardern,
my whole life my dad's called me a tree-hugging lefty. Why not round it out? Just
okay,
grab
so you
the
would,
tree.
You would change yourself to it.
I haven't. Do you know what, Paddy? I haven't to date because
one final question in the quickfire. One final question
in
the quickfire and you can get out of here. And it's a big one. Is it time for New Zealand to get a new flag? I'm just joking. Oh. Okay.
Well, I suggest that Miss Ardern takes it to referendum.
That's the end of the debate.
That's
the end of the debate. I know you want to keep going. We won't be looking for a new flag from either of you. Jacinda Ardern, Judith Collins, thank you both so very much.
Thank you.
But the night is not over. In a moment, political editor Tova O'Brien will be here on the stage with a team of experts to break down the performance, and it's not over for these two leaders either. They will be joining her. Will one of them be bold enough to claim victory?
really good evening. I'm Clover O'Brien, and what a clash of the titans it ended up being. We're going to talk to those titans shortly. Both Jacinda Ardern and Judith Collins will join me on the stage to tell me how they thought they went. But first, our very brilliant panel of experts this evening, the Hui host Mihi Ngārangi, Forbes political commentator Trish Sherson and political commentator Josie Pagani. Thank you guys so much for joining us. Before, I want to know who you thought won tonight. I also want to know what you thought were the ultimate clangers. But first, let's just take a quick look at the best bits of tonight's debate.
Judith Collins, you know, would you seriously say no to being on the cover of Vogue?
Oh, absolutely would I like to be there. There's no problem with that. I tell you what, Penny. Political leader who says they want it is a liar.
All right.
But Patty, the advice and the evidence I can already tell you because I've read it and I know it well.
Other than
to first establish spread would be dangerous, okay. Would be risky.
Well, actually,
okay,
that's what I'm hearing. Why are we now talking about a trans-Tasman bubble then if Ms Ardern's so worried about it?
Jacinda Ardern, have you ever used cannabis?
Yes, I did, a long time ago.
Tax break, and that's so that they can help grow the economy.
So tax cuts is your idea, Jacinda Ardern?
No, a sugar hit, it is not what we need right now. It is irresponsible. That, again, is only going to add to the debt that we need to keep a lid on.
1 week of the wage subsidy, your tax hike.
It's a waste.
I will never, ever say that $500 million is inconsequential.
Then why did you waste it?
Judith
Collins.
With companies
like The Warehouse. Why did you do that?
Is Winston Peters irrelevant?
Yes.
Jacinda Ardern, is Winston Peters irrelevant?
It would be a disservice of someone I've worked with for that long to describe him in that way. But ultimately, voters are going to make that call, Patty.
My, what a difference a week makes. It gives me tingles. Mihi, who won the debate for you?
Oh, look, they were both quick. I think ACT voters will think that that Judith Collins won because they got so many mentions in there. I think that, Labour and the Greens voters will be happy that climate change and those really serious issues we talked about tonight, half and half.
Half and half, down the middle. What about you, Trish? What do you think?
Well, I'm not sure it's appropriate, but what a bodice ripper that was. It was absolutely...
It was entirely appropriate.
Absolutely amazing. Both of them up the energy by about 300%, but I still think in this is a forum that Collins is absolutely revelling in, and I still think she was the winner on the night.
So a tie from Mihi, Collins just nudging across the line. Josie, who was the winner for you?
Well, first I'd say politics is the winner. I mean, last week it felt like, the opposite of politics is diplomacy. We don't want our politics to be about who gets the hors d'oeuvres. We want it to be a bit of a blood sport. We want to leave some blood and sweat on the table. We want them to take some risks and stand for something. So I think in that respect, they both came out absolutely batting changing rooms. They were out to be aggressive, both of them. But in the end, I think that Judith had it just ahead of Jacinda, especially at the beginning. Jacinda seemed a bit rattled, a little bit defensive. She really picked up towards the end of the debate. But there were a few weird moments too, and one of them was Jacinda...
the understatement of the debate.
..saying that she would have supported paying $12 million to the Green School. And I thought that was a bit of an own goal. Another weird moment was Judith, I think, praising Trump in a way that sort of struck a slightly odd chord and was an unnecessary bit of political sort of... she didn't need to do that, so...
What did you think the clangers were, Trish?
I thought the clanger probably for Judith Collins was around Trump. I thought it was just wonky and unnecessary.
Mm. And jarring as well with how she'd been through the rest of the debate, I thought.
100%. I thought the clangers for Ardern, though, probably overall, again, just way too high level. There really wasn't a lot of... If you think about tonight, there were a few things, and we'll come on to them, where we got some clarity and some sort of bottom lines, but it's just way too sort of woofy. And when Patty asked, I thought it was a great question, what was the one transformational idea to get New Zealand out of the COVID-19 economic hole? The answer was trading on our brand. I mean, it just doesn't actually cut it.
And Mihi, you quickly?
You know, it's always an election cycle thing, but the first time a Māori word was mentioned was by Judith Collins, and it was the Kahui twins, and they're rolled out every single election time. So, for me, that was, I had to have a sigh there because it happens every single time. I think for Jacinda Ardern, it's Ihu Matau because she never went, and it's always a difficult conversation for her out there because it's still not resolved, and that coalition didn't allow that to happen. And it has such a long history out there. You know, 1863, it was confiscated, it was given to settlers, and then it was in that one family, and then it was turned into an SHA, and then it was sold to Fletchers. So we have to get to the bottom of that, and I don't think either of them are kind of really there, are there yet.
Thank you very much. An hors d'oeuvre from our panel. Coming up, we get the lowdown from the leaders. Jacinda Ardern, because she lost the coin toss initially, she joins me right after the break. Welcome back. This is the Newshub Decision 2020 Leaders Debate Analysis Show. And here on the stage with me now is Jacinda Ardern. Jacinda Ardern, just before I ask you who you thought won that debate, I just want to throw to one of, there were so many best bits from both you and Judith Collins, but one of the early best bits of the night. Let's take a look.
COVID is much trickier than the Leader of the Opposition is giving any credit to, or credit to New Zealand and this entire team for the work that they have done to establish themselves as world-leading in our response. First thing. Second thing, tests before you fly do not prevent COVID being carried by a traveller. That's why quarantine and multiple testing is so important.
So this might not be an obvious best bit to everybody, but it stood out to us, because are you saying that Judith Collins doesn't understand the complexities of COVID-19 and that she perhaps doesn't understand what the team of 5 million went through to get us to this point?
For me, it was about crediting the work that everyone has done, and I'm very conscious that, yes, we should be acknowledging where we are in the world, but it is not a singular effort of one person. It has been an effort of an entire team. But also, it was me acknowledging that in this election, as much as any of us may not wish for it to be the case, when I'm out on the campaign trail, this is what voters are talking about. It's about our management of COVID, our plan for the future, and our recovery.
And did it have the added benefit of pitting Judith Collins against the country?
Well, in that opening section, you know, for me, there were a lot of comments made that I don't think acknowledge that it's not as simple as creating a new government agency and suddenly COVID ends. And we have to acknowledge that every country around the world has experienced how difficult this pandemic is. New Zealand happens to have done it well, and I will acknowledge the team.
Last election, during the Newshub or after the Newshub leaders' debate, you gave yourself a 6. You wouldn't say whether you won or not. What is it tonight? Who won?
I'm not even going to do a number this time. I actually didn't even... I was wondering last time whether or not I succumbed to that.
I'm here to help.
I'm sure who will give me a number regardless. I never declare. For me, it's all going to come down to, you know, a viewer watching is going to make that judgment.
But if you did have to give yourself a number 1 to 10, what would it be? Just if you had to.
You were going to use your whole segment on this section.
We'll just have to defer. We'll defer back to last election, and you can take the 6 again. A very different Jacinda Ardern tonight than we saw at the last leaders' debate. Was that intentional?
I always prefer a debate where there's a bit more room for people to make their view known. And so I always prefer a debate where there's a little bit less crossover in our answers. That's just me. That's how I do politics.
I didn't get that so much from you tonight.
I had to make a call. You know, either, you know, sit back and try and have that dialogue or make the point. I chose to make the point.
And you made an admission tonight, actually. Usually when we've asked you about whether you've smoked cannabis, you go back to this tried and true line, I was a Mormon
Which essentially, Tova, is an answer, if we're all being honest.
But why tonight more emphatic?
Oh, well, simply a shorter answer. It's saying the same thing. I have always said I was a Mormon, then I wasn't. People read between those lines.
And some commitments from you tonight as well. You said your heart is behind compulsory te reo Māori schools.
Yep. But let's be practical. You can't have that embedded in schools until you have the teachers. We're doing the work.
So is that now a campaign promise from Labor heading into
the next... whole reason we haven't done that is because we couldn't do it now even if we wanted to.
So if Labor can govern alone or with the Green Party, that's a promise for next term.
We will keep training our teachers. Once we have that core ability to do it, then let's talk. But actually, we shouldn't shy away from learning what is, you know, a language of New Zealand. It's a benefit to us.
Totally. So don't shy away from making that a commitment. Commit to compulsory te reo Māori in your first 100 days.
What you're asking me to do is give a date on something that until we have that workforce, I can't give you, Tova. But people know who I am. They've heard how I feel about the language, and they know our intent.
And what about a climate emergency? Would you do that in your first 100 days?
Well,
as
I pointed out, we already had a go, and it was voted down. But actually, those motions in the House are not the most important thing. The action is the most important thing, and that's what we always prioritised. A motion can be done in one afternoon. The action is what matters.
Thank you very much for your time, Jacinda Ardern. In the hot seat next is Judith Collins, and while we swap out our would-be Prime Ministers, let's keep an eye with the cameras on when they cross over and see what happens when those force fields collide. Let's take a look at Judith Collins' best moment this evening.
Judith Collins, is it time to abolish the right of silence in child abuse cases?
Yes, and we have promised that there will be a removal of that for those people who know about child abuse and who stand by and let this happen. We've actually had enough of this as a country, because no child
ever deserves to be abused as some children are. How many children have to die? Kahui twins are those that are most known. Delcelia Whitaker, many other children. And all the time, now we hear the story that the family will not cooperate with police. Well, actually, I've had enough of it, and I've said they do that, they can go to jail for 3 years, and while they're there, they'll think about their actions.
Judith Collins, National Party leader, thank you very much for joining me. I have a feeling that you might be less shy about declaring a winner this evening. Who was it?
Well, I felt very good, but I also thought it was a much more robust debate tonight, a much more energy, and I thought I did well, but I also think too, big winner tonight was politics, and I think the viewers would have enjoyed themselves.
Last week you called it for yourself. Do you call it for yourself again tonight?
Well, I thought I did well, but I think that actually, I really felt too, is that it was very enjoyable because it was more robust.
Mm-hmm. And if you had to give yourself a rating, 1 out of 10?
I think you're already doing it. I thought I did well, but I also, as I say, I enjoyed it. I could have gone on a bit longer.
Well, was tonight more of the kind of blood sport that you like to see in a debate?
Do you know, I don't know about that term. I think that people should have good, robust politics, but it doesn't have to be a blood sport, but it should be robust. And actually, I think people should be able to. I'll tell you what, I heard that there was, some debates are not so good. I've really enjoyed it tonight.
One of the moments that really stood out for me, and I'm sure that I join all of New Zealand in expressing condolences for your brother-in-law.
Yes.
Why did you decide to open up about him?
Actually, because his wife, who's my sister, rang me and said that I needed to let people know that people like my brother-in-law, Reg, got told that they had terminal cancer during the first lockdown over the phone and wasn't able to start any treatment or anything, and he got told that over the phone. Actually, it was awful.
I'm sorry to hear that. That investigation to Pharmac, it was interesting to hear from both you and Jacinda Ardern doing that commitment tonight. So is that something you would commit to in the first
Absolutely.
Days?
I think that Pharmac doesn't have an easy job because they're dealing with big multinational pharmaceuticals, who I can tell you, they're not generally in the business of providing drugs because they're just kind people. They're making a lot of money, and Pharmac does many cases a good job, but I think we need to actually go through that and see is it still fit for purpose. And by the way, what is the issue?
First 100 days, National
will
do that.
Yeah, we certainly do that.
That's going to be music to the ears of all of those people who have been campaigning so
too.
Hard.
Yeah. And
what about the gun register? Would you scrap that in your first 100 days?
Well, I thought we should be able to have one, but clearly, after all the money that's been spent on it all the time, it's not working. So actually, we're not going to do these things, these nice to haves as such, because it was cancelled about 20 years ago. I think it's just it's too late.
A few times this evening, you called Jacinda Ardern naive. There was a bit of a wince in the crowd as well when you said, "What for, dear?" Do you ever worry about coming across as a bit perhaps patronising?
Well, I guess that I'm just myself, you see. And part of that is that sometimes when I hear slogans being thrown around with absolutely no delivery, maybe someone who has spent a lifetime actually delivering on my promises, I do actually find it a bit galling to be given yet another slogan, whether it's about child poverty or anything else, when actually things have got worse, not better, after 3 years. So, I think sometimes people do expect that they will not just have these slogans thrown around.
So flip that for a second. If you had to give Jacinda Ardern one, commend her for one moment or for one line tonight, what would it have been?
Oh, I thought she had some good lines. I don't want to actually pick one out. I thought she had some good lines. And
including jeepers, when you said that David Seymour would be a great deputy?
Yeah, I tell you what, I'd rather have David Seymour than Winston Peters. I'd certainly would rather have David Seymour than some of the others on offering. I tell you what I wouldn't do. I'd never promote Phil Twyford to number four like she has.
That seems like a good place to leave it. Thank you very much, Judith Collins, for your time. The panel will be back in a tick, and we'll be talking about the clangers, the zingers, the surprises. But before we do that, who will govern is not the only question that we're being asked at this election. News Hub is here to help you decide on the referendums too.
New Zealand, we have some big decisions to make before the election on how we feel about cannabis and euthanasia. Before you vote, find out how each decision will affect your family, your kids, your community. Over two eye-opening nights, I'll host Kiwis from both sides of each argument, helping you connect the dots so you can have your say in the most informed way. Newshub, the cannabis question, Wednesday, October 7th, then the euthanasia question, October the 14th on 3.
I'm Tova O'Brien with the fastest turning around couch in the country. This is the Newshub Decision 2020 Leaders Debate Analysis. Very short, well actually we are being joined by our panel again now, Mihi Ngārangi, Forbes, Trish Sherson and Josie Pagani. So we talked before about the highlights and we talked about the clangers. What about the commitments that were made by these leaders tonight?
I thought it was interesting where there wasn't a commitment. So there was no plan B from either of them, actually. And Jacinda made that very clear. Note, we're elimination, that's it. So what if there's not a vaccine? And when Judith was asked the question, she kind of hedged it slightly. So it was the kind of lack of commitments on that, the lack of commitment on paying back the debt. So we know from one of the commitments, no super. There'll be no change to the age of eligibility for super. So, OK, we've got no super, we've got no tax switch, we've got no tax on capital. How are we going to pay for that debt? So the two lacking bits of substance. But, yeah, great to hear that Judith wants to be on the Vogue cover.
that was one of the cast iron election promises, yeah. Trish, what about you? Was it policy on the hoop, or is this actually quite a good place to be making announcements, making commitments, like we heard from both the leaders? And was it enough for you? Because I suspect it wasn't.
Yeah, well, I thought that's actually... I thought both leaders probably had read the poll today, which said Labor is more trusted on managing the COVID, the health response, and National actually had a good showing on the economic response. And I thought if you saw they're both playing to those bases tonight and in where they were really strong. If you looked at, again, I just think with Judith Collins, she has come into this matchup and her differentiation is policy and detail and straight talk. And she's realised that is kind of, in the way that they are very different people, that is the way that she can really speak to her base. So the really interesting points around that, obviously speaking to the farmer base again, speaking to the business base again, really trying to shore up that side for National, which was interesting. But I did think that Jacinda Ardern came tonight with a much fresher kind of an energy than she had last week, and she's obviously realised that the game has changed. And if you think about it, the momentum and the wind at the back coming into this was really Collins. And so I think that's why she really tried to nail it down tonight by having as many clear policies as she can and running them out really clearly.
Yeah, it wasn't 50 shades of beige. Yay that Auntie Kate's getting a statue at Parliament, because she's already got a bust inside. You know, I'd like to have heard that Princess Tapuia is going to be acknowledged some way. And actually, that's symbolic of what I'm going to say, because, you know, when they talk about Māori issues, they talk about disparities and inequalities and stuff. But, you know, we had a whole section there on the Māori economy. Neither of them tapped into the iwi who are in charge of $50 billion. How are we going to get out of this? How about engaging with them, you know? They're the treaty partner.
And what about the Prime Minister's commitment for compulsory te reo in schools, which seemed like a commitment and then suddenly didn't seem like so much of a commitment when she was sitting down here?
It's a start, you know, and I've walked alongside Pākehā who have learnt te reo Māori, and, you know, I've seen the way that they change and the way that they have a greater understanding of our country and the two people in this nation. So I think it's a great start. I think it's a worry that Judith Collins is only supportive of two languages and one not being Māori, you know, not being compulsory te reo.
On our last poll, the Labour Party was on 50.1%, the National Party was on 29.6%. What do you think that tonight's debate will do to those poll numbers?
Well, I mean, there's a concern for Labour that if the Greens come up too far, they want them to come a little bit, because if the Greens don't get back in, it's going to be, if their numbers drop just a little bit, they can't govern alone, and then you've got National Act being able to, you know, they're in for a go. But there's a danger with that if the Greens come up too far, then that could be a problem too.
And just quickly, Trish and Mihi?
Yeah, I mean, people discount the importance of these debates, but it does add to the momentum and the energy. And I think actually New Zealand is lucky to have had a debate of this quality tonight with leaders of this quality.
I think we always talk about the missing million or whatever it is, but I think we should really be looking out for our young people this year who are voting for the first time.
Thank you, all three of you, very much for joining us this evening. And that's it for the NewsHub Decision 2020 Leaders Debate. What a night. Thanks for joining us. NewsHub Lights are up after the break at 10:30. Just after 10:30, they have the full wrap of everything that unfolded on this floor tonight from everyone involved in this production. Thanks so much for watching. Good night.